Today we'll go a little further back, and essentially we'll talk about the ancient and the medieval period. Basically from the earliest times of history till approximately the coming of Akbar. That is the time period that we'll be basically covering. And essentially the theme of today's story is how this country became rich, why it was so rich, what went into the creation of this unique country. A number of you had asked questions which I didn't pick up last time or the time before. One core question was, what is India? So some of the what is India wala thing will be dealt with here. And another thing was about distribution of wealth. Is this a wealthy country? Is it a poor country? What happens to the wealth? So some of that also will be part of today's discussion. As usual, please feel free to stop me wherever you feel like asking a question. There is no specific question and answer session. So, jahan bhi aapke dil mein koi sawal uthta hai, turat farat rok dijiyega, and we'll carry it forward from there. Sabse pehli baat to ye hai ki some basic details about hamare yahan paisa kya hota tha, rukda kya hota tha, dhan kisko kehte the, dhan kaise banta tha. Phooti kaudi jante ho? This is a phooti kaudi. Phooti kaudi, jab bahut sari phooti kaudi hoti thi, to usse mila ke ek kaudi banti thi. Phooti kaudi is a proper money. You can buy things. 50 gram shengdana khareedna hai, mungfali khareedna hai. Khomche wale ko ek phooti kaudi do, wo aapko thoda sa mutti bhar mungfali dega, toongne ke liye, usko phir tod tod ke khate rehna. Phooti kaudi se kaudiyan banti hai. Bahut sari phooti kaudi mila lo to kaudi banti hai. 10 kaudiyon ko mila lo to damdi banti hai. Meri damdi kuch hai hi nahi. मेरे पास तो कुछ है ही नहीं. ये दमड़ी है. दमड़ी जो है वो 3/4 ऑफ अ पाई होती है. दो दमड़ियों का एक धेला होता है, ये धेला हुआ, और दो धेलों का एक पैसा होता है, और 64 पैसों का एक रुपया होता है. यू हर्ड ऑल दीज वर्ड्स बिफोर इन सम कलोकियल भाषा और दी अदर. Phooti kaudi to kaudi, kaudi to dambdi, dambdi to dhela, dhela to pai, pai to paisa, paisa to rupya, and look at the conversions. 256 dambdi barabar 192, pai barabar 128, dhela barabar 64, paisa barabar 16, anas barabar 1 rupya. These conversion rates had been set up much before, before contemporary times, when some bright young sparks like you discovered that there's some other value to such numbers also. You go up to 1028, 1024, I don't know what, but ye jo computer science type ke log hai, bade complicated kisam ke numbers aage badha rahe hote hain. This is maybe the natural way of calculating that these people, our ancestors, discovered. Ye rupya kya hota tha, ye paisa kya hota tha? The earliest paisa that we have in India, the earliest coin that we have in India, is a bent bar coin. You take a silver bar, you bend it slightly, and you give it a stamp. That's around 500 to 600 before the current era, before Christ. That is the kind of coin which is more in use in India. That is from one of the Janapadas. And the thing to notice over there is that a certain abstract shape is being put on it. It's not just that there's a coin. कॉइन के ऊपर उन्होंने एक डिजाइन भी डाला है, विच इज नॉट इजी टू इमिटेट, विच मीन्स दे आर क्रिएटिंग सम काइंड ऑफ अ यूनिकनेस टू दिस थिंग. बाय द टाइम ऑफ द मगधन एम्पायर, अशोका द ग्रेट, दे हैव कम अप विथ अ कॉइन विच इज कॉल्ड अ रुपया. व्हाई शुड वी नो अबाउट द रुपया एंड द मगधन एम्पायर एंड द अशोका एंड द ग्रेटनेस ऑफ इंडिया? अरे भाई साहब, जो डीएनए की जब स्टडी होती है और ये कहा जाता है कि दिस इज व्हाट यू हैव इनहेरिटेड फ्रॉम योर एंसेस्टर्स. आई फॉर एग्जांपल हैव बीन टोल्ड दैट आई शेयर 85% ऑफ माय डीएनए विद अ बनाना. देयर इज अ कॉमनैलिटी. द कॉमनैलिटी इज नॉट जस्ट अबाउट डीएनए, द कॉमनैलिटी इज ऑल्सो अबाउट कल्चर्स एंड बिहेवियर पैटर्न्स. द लैंग्वेज दैट यू यूज अबाउट मनी, द मैनर इन विच यू डील विथ मनी, द मैनर इन विच यू आइडेंटिफाई मनी, that is something which has been part of Indian history, Indian culture. even before the term India had been coined, Hindustan had been coined, Hindu had been coined, and it has been consistently been with us. So what is a rupiah? Rupiah is a coin which has got a roop on it. Roop is what? Roop is something which is abstract. So you have a gol chakkar, the wheel, which is the dharma chakra, an indicator of constant movement, movement towards, then you sit down and you imagine, movement towards what? Movement towards, people say, the wise people say, movement towards truth, movement towards morality, movement towards goodness, movement towards God, and it's, you let your imagination work out. But essentially the thing that this society wants to say is that there's going to be a movement, and then there's an elephant on the coin. So, hathi ka roop hai, chakra ka roop hai, and these kind of signs which are unique to every king, every city, every town, every political entity, these signs we would discover being repeated over the centuries, till such time that there is a break, and approximately the 11th, 12th century, the Muslims come in, and the Muslims, the Afghans come in, and the Afghans give a sharp break in this history of India. One of the sharpest things they do is to change the currency. Now the rupiah is not important anymore. They bring in something called the jital. Have you heard about the jital, anyone? No, I did not know about jital till such time that I started studying history. Jital was the currency that had been in use in South Asia, in West Asia, right up till the borders of Turkey for 600 years. It was the Afghans who had brought this currency in, had started giving it value, and it was the normal common currency. The old history of India had been forgotten, that there's something called a rupiah. People knew it in their memories. You haven't seen a kauri or a dambri, but you remember the word, you've heard it being used somewhere. Chances are that as you grow older, you'll use those words off and on, and the next generation that will come after you will also be familiar with those words. These memories, these ideas, they don't die off very easily, and yet it's possible to sideline them entirely and bring something new. And that something new with the coming in of the Afghans was the jital. The Afghans also brought in many other things. They brought in a new religion, in a religion which had been in existence in India for almost 400 years now. They brought in that religion in a form which was so aggressive that the memories of that aggression remain with us till today. We don't remember the Moplas who settled in Kerala. We don't remember the Bohris who settled in Gujarat. We don't remember the numerous traders who came and settled in Punjab or in UP or in Bihar. But we all remember the sultans who came aur jinhone hazaron lakhon ki tadad mein logon ko halak kiya. The sultan's documentation says that they killed off the Brahmins. Sorry, they didn't kill off the Brahmins. They actually killed off the Buddhists. The Buddhist religious leaders, the Buddhist monks, followers of Buddha, they vanished. That was the main religion of India. Not Hinduism, Brahmanism, Vedic religion. They were not the main religions. The Afghans brought in a kind of change which dramatically transformed Indian society. The Afghans remained in power for quite some time. They brought in a lot of other kinds of changes. But within the Afghans, there was a unique character. The unique thing about the Afghans was that the Afghans were extremely hierarchical. The Afghans were very snooty. And there was a handful of Afghan families which ran India. Everyone else was below them. Everyone else was a servant. Everyone else did not have the right or the privilege to assert themselves in public. Is puri halat mein, there was this small family from Sur which had a boy called Sher Shah. He's taken over this title, and they live in Rohtas in Bihar. He's born in Bihar, so he may have, his father and his grandfather may have come from Afghanistan, but he's basically a Bihari, born and brought up in Bihar. And he is most upset with the behavior of the Afghan nobility. He says, these guys are useless. They don't have any skills, they don't have any knowledge, and yet they dominate. That's very unfair. And as soon as he gets an opportunity to rebel against them and to do something of his own, he starts doing it. He joins the Afghan army. He becomes part of them. And now we have his history from his own sources. He marries a widow. It's a rich widow. The widow dies, leaves all her wealth to him. He marries a second widow. She also dies, leaves all the wealth to him. He marries a third widow. She also dies, leaves all his her wealth to him. Now, if this guy is marrying three times, I'm sure that people like him. At least the girls like him. Because he doesn't have any extra authority or power to force anyone to marry him. And what does he do with this wealth that is coming his way? The wealth is coming his way in the form of sona, gold. He starts hiring soldiers. Till now, the army is made up of people who have been given iktas, who have been given land grants, and the revenue from the land grant is collected to fund your army. This fellow starts giving salaries to his soldiers, cash payment hoga, Friday ke din hoga. And all of a sudden, he discovers that the best soldiers in the land want to work with him. He says, you won't get any hissa from the loot. There is going to be no loot part anywhere in the ladai jagda that we do. But you will be paid on time and you are guaranteed a payment. All of a sudden, there's a huge army that stands with him. He moves forward to Delhi and he occupies Delhi and he kicks out the Mughal who has come in, and the Mughal Sultan is kicked out. Sher Shah Suri sets up his rule. His rule lasts a total of 5 years. You've all heard of Sher Shah Suri, no? Because in India's history, Sher Shah Suri ke baare mein kaha jata hai ki usne sadak banayi thi aur usne bahut sare land reforms laaye the. Now, all that starts happening in a span of 5 years. In this period of 5 years, one of the big things which Sher Shah does is he kicks out the jital and he reintroduces the rupiah. Sher Shah is saying, as effectively as anyone else can say, I don't belong to an Afghan ancestry. I am a person from this land. I remain with this land, and the signs and symbols of an alien culture, he removes that. Sher Shah dies off. Humayun comes back. Akbar comes in. Akbar is a young lad. And Babur is a sultan. Humayun is a sultan. And as soon as Akbar gets the first opportunity to assert himself, Akbar says, I am not a sultan. Who is a sultan? A sultan is someone who is subordinate to the Badshah, to the Khalifa. The Khalifa who has his base in Turkey, who will finally be kicked out by Kemal Atatürk in 1923. When Turkey has a revolution and the military takes over, democracy is introduced in Turkey, etc., etc. But much before Kemal Atatürk, Akbar says, I don't care for this kind of authority. I am a Badshah of my own sort. He establishes himself as a Badshah, which also means ki jab namaz padhi jayegi, to namaz mein Bhagwan se prarthna ki jayegi, khutba kehte hain usko. So that prarthna will be in the name of Akbar, not in the name of the Khalifa. Akbar has set himself up as a completely autonomous sovereign who is not subordinate to anyone. And one of the first things Akbar does is he starts insisting that no one has to use the jital anymore. Using the jital is a crime. Using the rupiah is something that you have to do. So Akbar ke baare mein jitni bhi janjal ki kahaniyan aapne suni ho, aajkal politics mein bahut kuch ho raha hai ki sadak ka naam Akbar road kyon hai, iska naam Maharana Pratap road kyon nahi hai wagera. The point is this, this is one of the first kings of those times who openly and clearly asserts that he is rooted in this land, he belongs to this land, and he is going to work for this land. How does he do it? What does he do? The simple point for us is today that he picks up strands from the history of India, strands going back over 2000 years at that time. Even at Akbar's time, ye 2000 saal purana rupiah hai, jisko ki Akbar wapas introduce kar deta hai. Ye to kahani ka ek hissa hai. Kahani ka dusra hissa ye hai. I had promised you people that I'll be talking to you about the development in medical sciences and stuff. I'm not going to tell you about everything that was happening in medical sciences, but there's this small piece of information that you need to keep in mind. In India, we have a detailed report coming up in 1794 about, in an English journal, about a rhinoplasty operation, the reconstruction of the nose of this gentleman called Kovasji. Kovasji, the report says he is a Maratha. Now, Kovasji is not a Maratha name. Kovasji is a Parsi name. The context is that Kovasji is a bullock cart driver. Parsis are not bullock cart drivers. They are owners of caravans. They own thousands of bullocks, thousands of carts, and they hire these to the king for transporting military goods, hire them to businessmen for transporting bulk goods elsewhere. This is the time when the Marathas are joining hands with the British against Tipu Sultan. Tipu Sultan decides to attack the Marathas and first curb them. Part of that strategy is to attack the Maratha caravans. It is in that attack that Tipu's army attacks the caravan of which Kovasji is also part. Kovasji is captured and his nose is chopped off. 1 year elapses and Kovasji comes to this doctor, and these doctors, it's not one doctor, it's three doctors. These three doctors, they operate on him, they reconstruct his nose, and the English doctors of the East India Company are observing all this. They write a detailed report of this in the form of a letter. They draw pictures and they send it to London. First it is published in India, a year later it is published in London, and they all say wonderstruck that this is a normal, regular operation that happens in India. This is not something that is a rarity. It is commonplace knowledge in India. We need to learn this from India. This is something unique which we have not been able to discover through our sciences. Kuch samay pehle Narendra Modi ne rhinoplasty ke baare mein kuch jokes crack kiye the, and the whole country like split up, ha ha ha, what an idiot he is. Excuse me, Narendra Modi idiot nahi tha, jo has rahe the wo the. The simple point here is this, it's not just the rupiah which is continuing with us, it is also these medical skills which are continuing with us. These medical skills, their processes, their instruments, how exactly they should work out, all this has been described in the Sushruta Samhita, which could date anything from 600 BCE till 400 CE, 400 current era. We let the historians fight about ki ye kitab kab sach mein likhi gayi thi, or Sushrut was one person or Sushrut was many persons. Woh historians ke jhagde karne ki baat hai. From our point of view, the simple thing is this, that there was a continuity of knowledge from ancient times till at least the time when the British have come here. And we know that once the British come here, just like Afghano ke aane ke samay pe, there was a disjunction between what had happened in India in the past and what would happen in India during the Sultan's time. Some kind of a disjunction happens during British times also. As soon as the British come and occupy and become the paramount power in India. Kyon ye disjunction hota hai, is disjunction ko kaise toda ja sakta hai, wo sab alag ki kahaniyan hai. Main cheez ye hai ki disjunction itna tagda hota hai ki we absolutely forget all these things. And today we think that what existed in the past did not, or what our stories claim to have existed in the past actually did not exist. The fact that some of these statements and descriptions are made as metaphorical statements, they make it even more difficult for us to imagine. Professor Kavi Arya was just telling us about how engineers think in very objective ways. Sir, I would add, not engineers, all Indians think in objective ways today. It's close to impossible for Indians to imagine that there's a metaphorical way, there's a symbolic way of communication. The olden ways of communication are simply lost today. We have become a completely modern society. Jo philosophy ke log hai, they would say, we have become a Cartesian society. A society which has divided the world into Cartesian groups. Each entity has to be understood in its own. Once you have understood the parts, you bring them together and the whole is made. My suspicion is that sometimes there are structures when you bring the parts together, it's much more than the whole, that the parts, like the whole is much more than the addition of the parts. How this would work out for us in history, how this would work out for us in society, that is something which we have to wonder about, which we have to explore, which we have to think about how it can be done otherwise. ये साथ में मेरे को लेडी शूर्पणखा की कहानी भी थोड़ी सी याद आई थी कि सबसे पहला डिस्क्रिप्शन नाक कटने के बाद नाक वापस जुड़ना तो शूर्पणखा का था, पर अब अपने को पता नहीं कि शूर्पणखा की नाक सच में जुड़ी थी कि नहीं, सच में कटी थी कि नहीं, लक्ष्मण भाई के साथ क्या प्रॉब्लम थी कि क्यों अच्छी सुंदर सी लड़की आई और उसके साथ ऐसी बदतमीजी कर रहे हो. तो ये सब चूँकि ये सब कहानी किस्से की बातें हैं तो मुझे लगा कि बच्चों को ऐसी चीज़ें ना ही बताओ तो अच्छा है, पर तब भी लिखने का तो मन किया मेरा. ये जो हिंदुस्तान है, दिस इंडिया दैट वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट, ये इंडिया क्या है? दिस इज अप्रॉक्सीमेटली इट, यू हैव टू लुक एट थिंग्स, और एटलीस्ट दिस इज हाउ आई वुड रेकमेंड दैट यू लुक एट थिंग्स. दिस वे ऑफ लुकिंग एट थिंग्स इज नॉट पार्ट ऑफ इंडियन हिस्ट्री. आईपीआर के सवाल हो तो आई वुड से आई एम वन ऑफ द फर्स्ट पर्सन इन इंडिया एटलीस्ट हु हैज बीन टॉकिंग अबाउट द ज्योग्राफिकल स्प्रेड ऑफ इंडिया. दिस इज द ज्योग्राफिकल स्प्रेड, दिस इज द वर्ल्ड which has been in touch with each other ever since we know of history. People would start from somewhere in South Africa, the currents would take them all over, they have discovered the monsoon currents, you get into a boat and you just sit like a kaddu, and if you have taken your boat into the ocean at the right time, at a speed of 37 knots your boat will be pushed towards India, depending on which dhara you have gone into. Either you will come along the coast or you will come straight towards India. The normal way of navigation, the normal scientific way of navigation is to follow the coastline so that you don't get lost. If you read European stories of navigation, they are all moving along the coast. Is area mein aisa koi along the coast ka chakkar nahi tha. Yahan se jahaj mein baitho, patak se yahan jao, coast kahin nazar nahi aata. 2000 mil dur hai coast aapka. It is the currents which is taking you. People are routinely and normally moving. You pick up your stuff over here, get into the second jahaj and go further east. Aur wahan se palat ke isi tarah se jaise aapka season badalta hai, June ka mahina aata hai to wahan jahaj mein baith jao, wapas Africa aa jaoge. This body of people is in constant touch with each other. This body of people is identifying themselves as one single whole. But in this one single whole, this body of people is also identifying this patch of land is unique. This patch of land is unique because it is isolated from the rest of the landmass. On one side is Balochistan and the desert. There are the mountains, there's the desert, and then you move into the Indus Valley area. When you cross the Sindh, Sindh is a very broad river. So when you cross the Sindh, you know you've crossed a major landmark. If you come up from the north, from the what is currently Afghanistan, you once again, those of you who have been into the Himalayas would have experienced this. You're walking plain abhi aise and achanak pahad samne aa jata aisa. The pahad is so dramatic, so unique that there's simply no gradually pahad pe chadhne ka chakkar. Wo diwar ke jaise aapke samne khada hota hai. When you come via Afghanistan, when you cross the Himalayas, the disjunction between the land before the pahad, on the other side of the pahad, and this side of the pahad is so dramatic that you cannot but realize that you have come to a new land. Forget language, forget food habits, forget clothes. Just the physical location is different. And the same goes if you go east. This land was a land about which I have talked to you earlier. If you compare it with Europe, look at the population and the size, you discover that this land was very sparsely populated. Europe ka jo total area hai wo hai 10.18 million square kilometers. South Asia ka hai 5 million square kilometers. South Asia bole to Afghanistan se leke coming up till the borders of Burma. All of South Asia, 170 million population. No, not including Burma. Burma is across the mountain ranges. Now you've already got a broad forest area and it's difficult to cross. There are a lot of tribes which are eager to kill you. So you basically remain in the Brahmaputra Valley, or you remain in what is the Bangladesh ka jo delta region hai, you remain over there. Burma became part of India with the British. Burma has been in touch with India throughout history. वो जो पिछला वाला था, but the thing is कि you know that that is a different area from this. Just like there's a lot of continuity from here to here, but still you recognize that this area is different. The main thing is this, see, कि India is being identified as a unique, different place as compared to the rest of Asia. Two points. एक, Asia as a trading, cultural, political entity is distinct from the rest of the world. Asia, Africa, they belong to one unit. Within this unit, there is a special subunit which would be called India. And everyone who comes across into this land, he says, I've come to India.
Considering that Thailand and Cambodia
are part of India. Far away, the sea over here is very treacherous. So you don't easily cross this sea. You have to be a skilled Navik. So you know that when you are going into those lands, you are going into a different land. Moreover, they are very densely forested. And the forest over there is very different from the forest in South Asia. The Indian forests are forests. आपको कभी जंगलों में घूमने का मौका मिले यदि आगे, तो आप हिंदुस्तान के जंगलों में ऐसे ही चले जाओ बगैर किसी सामान के, and you will be able to survive very easily. You don't need any specialized survival skills in order to survive and thrive in the jungles of India. Thailand, Malaysia में ऐसा नहीं है. There you need special skills. The people over there have difficulty in living there, and therefore the people in Thailand and Malaysia were relatively poor people most of the time in history, in contrast to what happens in South Asia. The simple point also is this, that in this extremely sparsely populated land, the land is very rich, the land allows you to survive and thrive very easily. Even today, people who know about agriculture, they say कि आपके पास हिंदुस्तान में बहुत सारा ऐसा इलाका है जहां कि आप बस जाके ऐसे अनाज फेंक दो और तीन महीने बाद आप वहां हार्वेस्ट कर लो, आपको अपना सारा का सारा अनाज मिल जाएगा, साल भर खाने के लिए हो जाएगा, थोड़ा सा बाजार में बेचने के लिए हो जाएगा. यू रियली डोंट नीड टू वर्क मच. यू रियली डोंट नीड टू वर्क मच इज द बेसिक आइडेंटिफाइंग कैरेक्टरिस्टिक अबाउट इंडिया. इट्स अ लैंड रिच इन honey and milk and gold and silks. You can get your honey quite easily, you can get your milk very easily, you can get your gold very easily, you can get your silks and cottons very easily. You really don't need to work hard. So what is hard work? I mean, to tell you guys that you don't need to work hard, aap to ekdam se 2 second ka object karoge, bologe ki ji abhi to hum padhai padhai inne se nipte aur itni mehnat kar rahe hain. Believe me, the struggle for existence in India throughout history has been a very easy struggle. Indians have had it, some of the easiest lives in the world through history. Even today it's not a very difficult life. Thoda jyada kaam karna padta hai, thodi samasyaen jyada ho gayi hain, but otherwise India has been an easy on its people. Because you didn't have to work much, India seems to have gotten into the memories of the rest of the world as the place where you don't work much. The Europeans even had a whole image of the land of the lotus eaters. What do? They simply hang around, kamal kakdi khate rehte hain. Aur ye jo kamal kakdi hai, ye meethi hoti hai. Not the kind of kamal kakdi which you get in the market nowadays, jo ki tasteless hoti hai. Yadi aap जंगली कमल ककड़ी को खाए तो जंगली कमल ककड़ी मीठी होती है. हैव यू पीपल ईटन कमल ककड़ी? यू नो व्हाट अ कमल ककड़ी इज ना? नाउ इट इज पार्ट ऑफ यूरोपियन मेमोरीज. इट गोज इनटू होमर्स डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ ओडिसी इन द इलियड अबाउट दिस पीपल हु डोंट वर्क. ऑल दैट दे डू इज जस्ट हैंग अराउंड, लिव अ वेरी कंफर्टेबल लाइफ. एंड दिस इज वन ऑफ द इलस्ट्रेशंस की कैसे वो comfortable life basically means ki bas pade raho and you are very happy. This way of living would be called a serendipitous way of living. The word serendipitous came to us somewhere in the early 20th century when the Europeans started talking about, kyunki early 20th century mein India tab is tarah ka nahi bacha tha. इंडिया में गरीबी हो गई थी, भुखमरी हो गई थी, भूखे नंगे लोग दिखने लगे थे. दे स्टार्टेड टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस फॉर श्रीलंका. The European name for Sri Lanka is Serendip. So Serendip mein log is tarah se rehte hain. So they came up with a word called serendipitous, serendipity. What is serendipity? You just sit, you stare at the wall, wonder kya karna hai, kaise karna hai. Have you people gone to an art gallery ever? You just go and have a look at a painting, read meanings into it, find new things to do about it. You just imagine. In our university, we have a department called the Department of Maths. They actually should be called the Department of Numbers, because they don't do the kind of maths which everyone else seems to be doing. They are mostly good at number systems. And my colleagues who hate the mathematic people, they say ki inte ke is tarah ka jo mathematics tha na, ye 40 saal pehle khatam ho gaya, ab iska koi value nahi hai. Pata nahi mathematics wale aapas mein kya jhagde karte hain, is that the right way of working or wrong way of working, I don't know. But I do know how they work. They just hang around and they talk. Achha, to film dekhna chahiye ki nahi dekhna chahiye, ye karna chahiye, wo karna chahiye. Coffee mein chini jyada hai ya coffee ka temperature kam hai. And then all of a sudden they'll simply leave everything. Yaar, main aata hu. And they'll push off, they'll go off to their room and they'll start writing something. Poochho kya kar rahe the wahan, kyunki wo aadha paun ghante banda aaya nahi. Turns out ki uske dimag mein ek idea aaya tha na, wo idea ko likh raha tha. They take it very seriously. This is what perhaps is all serendipity all about. You just hang around, take life comfortably, play around with ideas, throw up new ideas and work on them. In the case of India, it seems to have given very positive results, historically positive results. A good thing in many ways. One of the ways in which it seemed to be good that we can see is in the number system. The discovery of zero, the discovery of the solution to the quadratic equations, the discovery of the sine function, development of the Indian variety of mathematics for quite some time. Zero, counting from 1 to 9 was normal. People knew about zero also for a very long time. Zero was something where there was a gap between two numbers, it was a zero. But the fact that you can give a place value to zero, this was something which required serendipitous thinking. This required some professor to just sit at his table and imagine. And this guy, he does all this imagining, Brahmabhat, and he comes up with this idea ki if you give it a place value, it starts making sense. In the 7th, 8th century in Gwalior, we even find an inscription approximately the same time as Brahmabhat is working in Ujjain. We find an inscription in which we can notice 1 and 0. Hame physical proof mil jata hai ki 0 ko place value dal ke kaam kiya jane laga tha is waqt. Ab baki hame memories ke proof hain. Kuch ikka dukka written documents milte hain. Par ye ki this was how people, students were being taught now. This was how knowledge was being communicated. Hame uska concrete archaeological evidence mil jata hai through this inscription. And why was it that Mr. Brahmagupta is discovering this zero? He's discovering it. My submission is, I mean, other people give other kind of answers. My suggestion is this happens simply because it's possible for him. He's living in a society where he does not have to fill up ACRs. He does not have to show performance. He does not have to claim something new all the time. He can just hang around and imagine and do things. There would have been hundreds of others like him. He was the one who came up with this idea. Others may or may not have come up with this idea, we don't know. But the thing is, jab aap logo ko is tarah ka freedom dete ho, then it becomes possible for them to move forward and create something unique, which is also abstract. And one of the suggestions that has been made is that it becomes possible for him to talk about this thing in abstract, because he's coming from India, where there is already a philosophical concept called Shunya. The philosophical concept of Shunya has been wedded to the mathematical idea of zero, and they have been put together, and a completely new way of doing mathematics comes into existence. Discovery of zero opens up an efficient way of calculating very large numbers. It enables people to discover things which could not be imagined till now. The rules of zero that Brahmagupta gives to us are about multiplication, sorry, addition, subtraction and multiplication. You add zero to something, it remains 1. You subtract 0 from 1, it remains 1. You multiply 1 with 0, it becomes a 0. But what happens if you divide 1 by 0? And his imagination falters and he does not know what to do about it. It remains like this for a few hundred years. People have discovered the value of account keeping, easy account keeping. So this is not just a mathematical discovery done in a serendipitous manner, etc., etc., just in case you are thinking ki lotus eaters kaam kar rahe hai. Iski immediate practical value hoti hai. And the immediate practical value is that trade booms even more. Large scale trade starts happening. Records start getting kept, which then become sources for history for us. The businesses start giving money on biaj, because now it is possible to retain records for a much longer period than had been possible earlier. It is Bhaskara who comes up with the idea that what happens if you divide something with zero. And that idea also comes in a serendipitous manner, infinity. Now you have from, first you were imagining shunya, kuch bhi nahi, and now you are imagining infinity. And between infinity and shunya comes a Madhava of Sangama Grama who says, now I will tell you how to calculate the value of pi. The value of pi is known to people, 22 bata 7. But exactly 22 bata 7 ko kaise describe karenge? This is not something that they know. And they come up with approximations, 3, 3.1, 3.14. A lot of people are working on it. It is this guy who says, ki, no, now that we have infinity, now that we have the value of shunya, it's possible for me to calculate the value of pi till the point that you wish to calculate the value of pi. He and his students, between them, he's from Kerala, between them they open up an entire area of research for people. An entire area where you could now start constructing buildings, you could start constructing huge structures. But there was also another thing that he comes up with, and he says that numbers can also be negative, rin. Now that this idea is coming from businesses. Business mein rin hardam hota hai. To wo kehta hai yadi business mein rin hota hai to hum isko ganit mein bhi likh sakte hain. Ganit mein rin likh diya jata hai aur jaise hi aap ganit mein rin ko samajhna shuru kar dete ho, aapke paas quadratic equations ke solutions aana shuru ho jate hain. Quadratic equations ke solutions aate hain, negative solution bhi usme valid solution mana jane lagta hai. And this is something which the Europeans will discover only in the 17th century. The 17th century Europeans are challenging each other ki tum ye karke dikha sakte ho kya? India mein ho to bahut pehle ho chuka hai. There's a thing that you will have to keep in mind. India mein jo hua tha uska natija kya nikla aur Europe mein jo discovery hui uska kya natija nikla? These are two divergent ways of doing things. Europe mein ye sari discoveries ka natija hota hai, modern science booms. India mein about all that happens is accountancy booms. Did we say anything about Indians being basically money minded? If I had not said it earlier, please let me put it now. Indians have throughout history been extraordinarily money minded. Paise ka pyar Hindustan mein sabse jyada rehta hai. Yadi aapko kabhi Kautilya padhne ka mauka mile, Hindi mein padhiyega Kautilya, Angreji mein na padhiyega. Ya Hindustani bhasha mein padhiyega. Translation from Sanskrit into whatever Indian language you can speak and read. Har jagah Kautilya keh raha hai. Dushman ko kaise hai jeetna chahiye? Paise de do, jeet jaoge. Dushman ke general ko kaise jeetna chahiye? Usko bhi paise de do, aapki taraf aa jayega. Dushman ke beton ko kaise jeetna chahiye? Unko bhi paise de do. Dushman ki janta ko kaise jeetna chahiye? Usko bhi paise de do. And just in case you think that this is very bad and this was that Kautilya ki kutilta thi aur ye to Hindustan ko bekar mein aap beizzat kar rahe ho, aisi baat nahi hai. Aaj bhi bilkul aisa hi hota hai. Prakash Singh Badal wants to win the elections against the Congress. So he goes and he gives the fellow in the Congress who has not been given the ticket. Ticket bat rahi thi, ek bande ko party ki ticket mili, dusre bande ko nahi mili. Aur jis bande ko ticket nahi mili thi, usko jaake wo paise deta hai. Le, tu election lad, main tere election ko fund karta hu. Wo banda election khada hota hai, Congress ka banda election khada hota hai, election Prakash Singh Badal jeetta hai. Akali dal jindabad ho jata hai. This is something which Prakash Singh Badal and Nitish Kumar and Narendra Modi are doing in India, but this is also something which the Americans are doing in Afghanistan. All of a sudden, early in the 21st century, Afghanistan is in turmoil. The Taliban has come into existence. The Taliban is rebelling right, left and center and occupying all of Afghanistan and killing people at whim. The Americans come in with their bombs and everything, and the Americans try to bomb the Taliban out, and they discover that it's not possible. So after some time, they read up their quartile properly and they say, okay, so you got 50 men and you got some weapons with them, and you have already killed 15 Afghans. You have demonstrated that you are a power in that village where you live in. Fine. Kitne paise loge? $50,000 loge ya $1 million loge? Every Talibani commander is purchased off by the Americans. The Talibanis who had been talking about Afghanistan ko swatantra karke rahenge, hamara jirga sabse mahatvapurna hai, hamare gaon ko hum kabhi bhi kisi ke adheen nahi hone denge, sare ke sare bik jate hain. Sorry, ye galat shabd main istemal kar raha hu. Aajkal ye protestant kisam ki zindagi, jo modern zindagi jisme morality bahut hoti hai, usme hum kehte hain ki wo bik jate hain. Bikte nahi hain, wo paisa lete hain, and for the time being they stop killing each other. Kautilya comes to the aid of the Americans. This is the kind of continuity that we keep on seeing in India, and the love that Indians have for money, and therefore all this mathematics sticks to money, power and authority. There is no development of science as far as I understand. The one thing which breaks the bonds of old traditions is the discovery of the new kind of trigonometry. The Indian mathematicians come up with ways of finding the sine value of close to anything. You give them the angle and they'll be able to tell you the sine value. The Greeks also knew sine value, and they would be able to tell you the sine value of 0, 30, 45, 60 and 90. Indians have figured out ways of telling you the value of any angle. Now, once you know how you can give the sine value of any angle, this is sine 30. Anyone remember sine 30 ka kya value hota exactly? 0.5. That's how it comes out. So all that you need to do is find it out. And once you've discovered the sine value of 1 by 7, then you can actually just put your finger like this, measure the angle between the sun and the moon, and you can sit back and say, how, what is the distance from the earth to the sun? What is the distance from the earth to the moon? The sun is 400 times more distant than the moon. Then you sit at some other place in a different season and you take a reading on the moon, and you know the exact distance between the sun and the moon, and now you just have to extrapolate it to give you the distance between the earth and the sun. You have actually done what Galileo would be doing in Europe later on. You have actually opened up imagination for human beings. We have opened up things in such a big way that anyone can reach out anywhere. And this reaching out anywhere, it gets immediately translated into power in India, and it results in the emergence of some of the largest buildings in the world. Huge buildings. These huge buildings, one of my favorites is the Brihadeshwara temple in Tanjore. The Brihadeshwara temple in Tanjore comes up, and it has got this 80-ton stone on top of it. It's got this 80-ton stone on top of it, and how do you reach this stone over there? How is the temple constructed? We talked about this temple earlier. This is a temple in use for 1,000 years. This is a temple which has been extremely ill-treated by its users, and still the temple stands here, and this temple stands here because of that 80-ton rock on top of it. Because all the stones which have been cut properly. How do you cut these stones properly? The first stone has to be one size, the second stone has to be done just the right different size. So you can't have a production line in which you tell your karigar ki sab ek jaise kaat ke de dena. Nahi. Every stone has to be unique. So you've been able to do all that, and when it comes to putting this pathar on top, you ask your karigars to carve a pathar out, and then you build a ramp 8 miles long. There's no shortage of human power. There's no shortage of stones and rubble. So you collect human beings, rubble, etc., etc., aur 8 meel lamba aap ramp banate ho. Is 8 meel lambe ramp pe aap lakdi ke ballam lagate ho, jo gol lakdi ke logs hote hain wo rakhte ho. Uske upar ye gol patthar ko rakhte ho aur isko haathiyon se upar dhakelte ho. Aur upar le jaake is patthar ko shikhar pe mandir ke rakh dete ho. Uske baad, making the ramp was one effort. Then the second effort is removing the ramp. So now you get down to the task of removing the ramp. As you remove the ramp, it takes more time, more money, and this entire process takes you 10 to 15 years, not more than that. You have actually used human power in a manner which is in its most raw form. Just a little while later, they would be constructing St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. And St. Peter's Basilica in Rome also requires structures to go up. So how do they work on that? They work on it because there are limitations on how they will work. There's a lot of habitation all around, so you can't just make your 8-mile lumbar ramp anymore. You don't have so many people to construct the ramp, to dismantle it, to pull things up. So what they do is they create a crane. They use a screw mechanism to lift things up, and they have created a machine which can be used for hundreds of other tasks also. In India, because you had a lot of manpower, the manpower came cheap, you had adequate amount of time, and there were enough resources. There was abundance of land around, there was abundance of forests around, there was abundance of mud and rocks around. You didn't have to worry about any of that. So you actually, in a sense, after having taken a great leap forward, you have stopped. You have stopped just at the brink of becoming modern science. Because why you have stopped just at the brink of becoming modern science? Because you had a very comfortable life just before that. There was no reason for you to do something different. This, that you are not moving forward, is something that you also see in other areas of life. People stop trading. That big trade expeditions which had brought in all the wealth, which made you so rich. Now you don't need to trade. Apne ghar baitho. Bahar ki duniya ke log aake tumhe paisa dete jayenge, tumhara saman lete jayenge. All that you have to do is sit on your gadda and become rich and rich and rich. The Arabs step in, the Europeans step in, and all of them, they discover that the Indians are loath to do this kind of labor work. Was it just the Indians who were doing this? No, the Chinese did the same. The Chinese were in lagbhag approximately the same situation as Indians. Rich land, full of people, happy people, cheap food, cheap clothing, cheap living. They also, around this time, when they are at the top of the world, when they are one of the richest society in the world, they also stop working the same way that the Indians have stopped working. When you had asked me that question about poverty and wealth in India, the figures for poverty and wealth in India are that during Aurangzeb's time, which is the richest that India ever was in its history, there were 400 families which controlled about 90% of the wealth of India. 400 families. The rest of India controlled only 10% of the wealth. And most of India did not have any money at all. People were, if you use contemporary terms, people were poor. People lived in huts. People did not have pakka houses. There were no pakka roads ever. There were no pakka ports ever. All those ports through which those great trades are being carried out, they are all temporary structures. Aap jaate the, wahan balliyan laga dete the, platform khada kar dete the lakdi ka, aur jahaj Arabia se aate the, Africa se aate the, you did your trade and then you simply left. The monsoon came and took everything away. The next season you came and you did the same. You didn't even bother to construct roads anywhere. Why? Because all that you needed was, by the time of September, when the rains had gone off, you waited for 15 days more. By the 1st of October, it became possible for you to tread on the ground once again. And the first caravan which went, it made the road. So broadly speaking, you knew that from point A to point B, this is how you have to go. But those of you who have walked on kacha paths ever, you know ki jab aap kacche path pe chalte ho to dheere dheere wo safed sa banne lagta hai, dabne lagta hai, harden up ho jata hai. For one season you have a good road. The road starts deteriorating around the summer months when bail gaadiyon ke karan aur bail ke khuron ke karan wo khudna shuru ho jata hai. Then the monsoon comes and everything shuts down. We actually had a philosophy, Chaturmas ki philosophy. During the monsoon, don't move out. So for a full 4 months in this country, no one did anything. It was one big summer break, sorry, one big monsoon break. You just sat back home and you just imagined yourself. So what kind of a country was this? We have some visual evidence before us. This is King Ashoka with his queen and the servants. Have a look at the image. We know that this is King Ashoka, because soon after this particular image was found in Kanganahalli in Karnataka, a similar image was found in Odisha, jiske upar likha hua tha Ashoka Raya. Ashoka Raya means King Ashoka. And then you discovered that in a similar pose there is an image in Sachi. Now the Sachi stupa has been made during Ashoka's time. Ashoka is alive, he is the one who has made the Sachi stupa at Sachi, because his favorite wife was the daughter of a merchant of Vidisha. Vidisha is the town next to Sachi. So we know that Ashoka looks like this. And Ashoka is one of the richest kings of his times. Look at what he is wearing. Dhoti. Bhar ke kangan hai, haath mein. Koi chappal khada ho, kuch nahi hai, nange pair hai banda. Sir pe usne jo apna pagdi si dal rakhi hai, wo badi decorative hai. Usme bahut sari jewelry hai. Look at his wife. The image on the left side. She is just covered with a simple cloth. Bilkul jheena sa kapda hai. Aur bhar ke jewelry hai pure badan pe. Look at the servants around them. The servants are dressed the same way. The question that you asked, garibi or ameeri, the only difference is the amount of jewels that you are wearing or the value of the jewels. Baki everyone is wearing the same. Everyone is eating the same food. Everyone is doing the same. A while later, a few thousand years later, when the Europeans would come to India, and they would start noticing, they would say, what is wrong with these guys? This is the richest king in the world, and what does he do? He eats out of a mitti ka katora. Mitti ke katore se raja khana khata hai. How is that possible? Europe mein to wo banda chandi mein khata hai, sone mein khata hai. Jab aluminium ki discovery hoti to aluminium ke bartanon mein khana shuru kar deta hai. The way you demonstrate that you are rich and powerful is to change your lifestyle. You change your material culture. This does not happen in India ever. It does not happen in India till the 19th century when the European travelers come and say, ye jo Raj Mahal hai, inme almariyan nahi hoti. King apna kapda utarta aur khunte pe taang deta hai. Rani apne kapde utarti aur khunte pe taang deti hai, zameen pe chhod deti hai. Koi kapde teh karke rakhne ka system nahi hai. Maine pehle bhi ek bar aapse zikr kiya tha, aap logo ke jo hostel ke kamre jis tarah ke the, hamare sare raje maharaje bilkul waise hi raha karte the. आप लोग राजसी ठाठ बाट वाले लोग हो, हिंदुस्तान की परंपरा के मुताबिक चप्पल नहीं पहनते थे, नंगे पैर घूमते थे. आजकल थोड़ा हो गया कि चप्पल पहनना पड़ता है, या यदि आप नॉर्थ इंडिया में आए तो नॉर्थ इंडिया में पंजाब हिमाचल वाली साइड में जहाँ ठंड बहुत ज़्यादा होती है, जहाँ गर्मी भी बहुत ज़्यादा होती है, हर कोई जूते पहनता, वहाँ चप्पल नहीं पहनते. पर यदि आप बंबई आ जाएं या महाराष्ट्र में आएं तो आप पाते हैं कि यहाँ लोग जूते नहीं पहनते, यहाँ सब चप्पल पहनते हैं. जो जूते पहनने वाला होता है उसको लोग कहते हैं, साहब ना बहुत फॉर्मल है, जूते पहनते हैं हरदम. मैंने कहा नहीं नहीं, फॉर्मल नहीं, मेरे पास एक जोड़ी जूते ही है, चप्पल है ही नहीं मेरे पास. थिंग वॉज दिस, द मटीरियल कल्चर ऑफ द पीपल, द मैनर इन विच दे लिव्ड, दिस वॉज अ लो डिमांड कल्चर. इट डिड नॉट डिमांड टू मच फ्रॉम द सोसाइटी अराउंड, फ्रॉम द खजाना. So it was possible for you as a society to continue to live the way you were living, even when the economy was doing drastic ups and downs. Economic ups and downs did not hurt your way of living. Food continued to remain available in great abundance, and it became possible for everyone to be very comfortable and satisfied with themselves. Being comfortable and satisfied with yourself was something very problematic, as far as I understand it. It was not a good thing after a while. Maybe it was a good thing in Ashoka's time, but it definitely was not a good thing by Akbar's time or Aurangzeb's time. And one of the things that I start noticing is that in this whole system, there is absolutely zero effort at creating systems. There is absolutely zero effort at systematizing your trade, at systematizing loans, bank loans and such like. We've just seen that whole episode of Mallya running away with 9,000 crore rupees or whatever he has run away with. And most of the bankers have said, humne usse sun liya tha ki aise karna chahiye. And then the critics of the bankers say, dekho, usne promise kiya tha tumko ki wo paise leke bhagega nahi. This doesn't work out like this. You should have done due diligence, checked them out properly, conducted investigations, and on the basis of that, chuki tumne wo nahi kiya, this means ki tum log corrupt ho. मे बी करप्शन इसमें शामिल था, बट आई कैन अश्योर यू दिस इज हाउ इंडियंस डिड द ट्रेड मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम. दिस इज हाउ इंडियन बिजनेसेस वर बीइंग ऑर्गेनाइज्ड. इंडियन बिजनेसेस नेवर क्रिएटेड स्ट्रक्चर्स विच वुड इनेबल देम टू फंक्शन ऑन अ लार्ज स्केल. We had talked about the example of the East India Company, how the East India Company created bureaucratic systems and that enabled the company to dramatically transform the manner in which trade was being done. In India, even the king did not systematize his rule. The king simply depended most of the time on the manner in which chungi was being paid. Yadi 50% chungi bhi usko aa jati thi, baki लोग घूस वूस में खा जाते थे. ही वॉज हैप्पी विद दैट बिकॉज इवन दैट 50% लॉस मेंट दैट ही वॉज वन ऑफ द रिचेस्ट किंग्स इन द यूनिवर्स. सो ही रियली डिडंट हैव टू बॉदर अबाउट इट. व्हेन द मुगल्स कम, शेरशाह सूरी कम्स इन, ही ब्रिंग्स इन द फर्स्ट मॉडिफिकेशन. ही डज द जमाबंदी ऑफ ऑल एग्रीकल्चरल प्रोड्यूस. अकबर कम्स इन, ही सिस्टमेटाइजेज इट इवन मोर. दिस रिजल्ट्स इन अ ड्रामेटिक jump in the revenue which the state is earning. It results in more money with the king. It enables the king to have a larger army. But the big thing remains, the state still is a useless entity as far as the rest of India is concerned, because the state really doesn't know anything about what you or I as civilians are doing. So we are relatively immune from the authority of the state, which in turn also means that as far as we are concerned, as far as the people of India are concerned, the state is ignorable. You can ignore the state, it really doesn't matter. You don't even know where the state is, what the state does. Those of you who come from small towns, from towns outside of Maharashtra, you would have known how powerful the district magistrate is and the SP sahab is and the Thanedar sahab is. You come to Bombay, the SP sahab, Thanedar sahab really don't matter, because उनके जैसे तो हजारों लाखों यहाँ बॉम्बे शहर में है, महाराष्ट्र में जहाँ पे, गुजरात में जहाँ पे सारा बिजनेस कारोबार के आधार पे चलता है. दे डोंट केयर अबाउट द सरकार. सरकार तो टैक्स तक नहीं वसूल करती है. दैट इज नॉट द केस इफ यू गो टू पंजाब, हरियाणा, यूपी, बिहार, द नॉर्थ ईस्ट. ऑल दैट यू हैव टू से इज तमिलनाडु. हमने कितनी बार किया, गाड़ी में जा रहे हैं, चुंगी वाला आपको रोकता है कि पैसे दे के जाओ 25 रुपये आने जाने के. गाड़ी का ड्राइवर कहता है IAS की गाड़ी है, हाथ मत लगाना. वो चुंगी वाला कहता हाँ सॉरी सॉरी सर, आगे जाओ. यू डू दैट इन बॉम्बे, वो पकड़ के आपको जेल में भिजवा देगा. द स्टेट इज इग्नोरेबल. द स्टेट सेट्स अप रेवेन्यू सिस्टम्स एंड देन द हिस्टोरियंस ऑफ इंडिया स्टार्ट टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस रेवेन्यू सिस्टम इन अ बिग वे. द रिफॉर्म्स, एग्रीकल्चरल रिफॉर्म्स ऑफ शेरशाह सूरी, एग्रीकल्चरल रिफॉर्म्स ऑफ अकबर, एंड देन कम्स द इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी एंड इट सिंपली इनहेरिट्स द एंटायर रेवेन्यू सिस्टम ऑफ द मुगल्स एंड द ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी स्टार्ट्स कलेक्टिंग revenue. East India Company, we've already mentioned, is a bureaucratic company. And when the East India Company starts collecting revenue, we discover that the East India Company results in, East India Company revenue system is put in place in 1793, the permanent settlement, and by 1806, the entire agricultural system in Bengal and Odisha and Bihar has been destroyed. The traditional agricultural system, the traditional agricultural elite has been destroyed. And then everyone wonders ki this is exploitation by the East India Company. When you start looking at the details of history, it turns out that no, the East India Company was not doing any exploitation. The East India Company was just as much wonderstruck as to why there's a destruction of agriculture going on. And then it turns out that the East India Company was following the agricultural rates that had been fixed by the Mughals. The agricultural rates fixed by the Mughals were being followed by the East India Company. So the big question is, why does the agricultural rate fixed by the Mughals does not destroy agriculture in Mughal times, and why does it destroy in the times of the East India Company? So you start looking at what were the Mughals doing. It turns out ki Mughalon ka agricultural rate to tha ki 10% tax dena padega. But ye 10% tax ta 5-6 saal mein ek baar dena padta tha. Na Mughal ke paas record tha ki aapne tax diya ki nahi, na uska senapati aap mein interested tha, na uska khajanchi aap mein interested tha. Wo 4-5 saal baad usko yaad aata tha, oh, is gaon se tax nahi aaya, chalo is gaon pe chalte hain. Wo aapke gaon mein aata tha, kehta tha tumne pichle saal bhi nahi tax diya, haan huzur nahi diya. Uske bhi pichle saal nahi tax diya, haan huzur nahi diya. Uske bhi pichle saal tax nahi diya, haan huzur nahi diya. Pichli baar kab tax diya tha, huzur 5 saal ho gaye. Ab is baar tumko 6 saal ka tax bharna padega, wo 5 saal plus एक और साल प्लस थोड़ा सा फाइन. माई बाप, ऐसा क्यों कर रहे हो, क्यों गरीब के पेट पे लात मार रहे हो? अब ये तो सबको पता है कि 6 गुना टैक्स तो बंदा नहीं दे सकता, तो फिर लेट्स हैव अ नेगोशिएशन. नेगोशिएशन दो लेवल्स पे होता था. एक तो ये कि अंडर द टेबल तुम थोड़ा सा ले लो, मैं थोड़ा सा ले लूं. पर जो रियल टाइम नेगोशिएशन होता था वो ये होता था, अच्छा देखो इस बार तुम देहोड़ा टैक्स दे दो 1.5 टाइम्स, अगली बार भी 1.5 टाइम्स टैक्स देना, उसके अगले साल भी ऐसे ही देना, और ये तब तक कर रहा जब तक कि पीछे का जितना बकाया टैक्स है जो पेंडिंग टैक्स है वो पूरा ना हो जाए। हाँ जी ऐसे ही करेंगे, असल में क्या होगा, इस बार 1.5 टाइम टैक्स दे दिया, अगले साल की तो अगले साल देखना है ना, कौन सा अगले साल ये बंदा वापस आएगा टैक्स बटोरने के लिए। हो सकता है इसका ट्रांसफर ही हो जाए, मनसबदार ट्रांसफरेबल थे, रिमेंबर, ये ट्रांसफर हो जाए फिर जो नया वाला आएगा उससे नए सिरे से नेगोशिएट करेंगे। द इफेक्टिव थिंग वॉज दैट ड्यूरिंग मुगल टाइम्स इन प्री ब्रिटिश टाइम्स अ फेलो पेड ओनली अबाउट 1% टैक्स इन रियल टर्म्स। अब 1% टैक्स तो कोई टैक्स नहीं होता, उससे ज्यादा टैक्स तो वी आर पेइंग टू द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया नाउ डेज, एंड द ब्रिटिश सिंपली बिकॉज दे ब्रिंग इन अ सिस्टमेटिक वे ऑफ टैक्स कलेक्शन, इट रिजल्ट्स इन द डिस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर ओवर देयर। व्हाट वॉज गोइंग ऑन इन इंडिया? In India, my submission is that as a consequence of that great geography that we had, the great land that we lived in, the great philosophy which said that don't hanker for any more, be satisfied with what you have. Now, I can be satisfied with what I have if I already have quite a lot. I put my hand here and I get a fruit to eat. I put my hand here and I get a cloth to wear. I just put my hands behind my head and I'm able to sleep comfortably. I don't need to worry about anything. That was great for serendipitous living, serendipitous experimentation, but not hankering for anything was creating a problem for us. When we got in touch with the modern world, when we got in touch with the European world which was modernizing after the period of the Renaissance, which was developing modern science and technology, we didn't know how to cope with that world. We were adjustable. So in the first lecture we talked about how Indians created newer systems for themselves despite all the obstructions that the English company put before the Indians. How Indians started coming on tops in the economy. So it was not as if we didn't know how to do it. But as far as creating systems was concerned, we seemed to be lacking very seriously. And that lack perhaps continues to stay with us till today. And the big thing is those absences just may prove to be serious obstacles to moving forward in doing anything at this stage in our life. Where we stand in India today, to move forward, we need to understand how to operate on a large scale, how to coordinate thousands and thousands of people. Some of us have been able to figure that out. Infosys, for example, has been able to figure it out. TCS, Mahindra, I was in a meeting with some Mahindra guys just 2-3 days ago. And they've got 700 offices spread across the country. And they are able to coordinate each of them very easily today because they are following what they call a system. If we don't create systems for large-scale operations today, we will come croppers. This thing about startups, the great man who comes up and three people set up and they've got an idea and they work on it and they create something which is unique and they're able to earn a few million dollars soon after that. Sorry, that is not the way to go. That is the romantic way to go. The way to go would be to be able to create something which includes hundreds and thousands of people. Jack Ma is the way to go. Steve Jobs is not the way to go. Jack Ma is closer to our culture, closer to the way we do things. This is what I would say today. Next time that we meet, we will be talking about how Indians participated in knowledge management, social management. सोशल टेंशन क्यों नहीं होते थे इस समाज में, या जो होते थे उनको कैसे सॉर्ट आउट किया जाता था, बिकॉज दोज आर द क्वेश्चन विच विल पुट अ ब्रेक ऑन हाउ मच वी कैन इमेजिन टूडे अबाउट मूविंग फॉरवर्ड इन विच डायरेक्शन। दोज आर द क्वेश्चन विच विल पुट अ ब्रेक ऑन वेन वी हैव द राइट इमेजिनेशन एंड वी आर ट्राइंग टू कोऑर्डिनेट आर एक्टिविटीज, स्टिल इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल फॉर अस टू पुश फॉरवर्ड। तो कहाँ कहाँ से हमें ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन आ सकते हैं, हमारे लिए थ्रेट्स आ सकते हैं। Basically, SWOT analysis. Are you familiar with the phrase SWOT, S-W-O-T? Our strengths, our weaknesses, the opportunities and the threats to Indian society. Today, India is not that landmass that we had talked about earlier. Today, India is a legal entity, fairly well defined. And within this, whether we like it or not, we are stuck with each other. We are stuck with each other with all our differences, with all our uniquenesses and with all our absurdities. And yet we have to live together and respect each other. So how does one find a way out? Next time that we meet, we'll talk a little more about that. Thank you so much.
I think, you know what, I have a very a thought on this systems approach. I personally believe that systems, setting a proper organizational process and standardization, and I think this is one thing which Americans have led so much emphasis on standardization of everything, which has helped them go a long way in terms of mass production and, you know, also, like for example, we have not had any kind of standard right from our switches. Somebody has it this way, pivot this size. This affects the whole manufacturing process. And as a consumer, it becomes expensive to me. Today what I am using, I cannot use it tomorrow because I don't have a similar, I cannot just replace a similar. So like systems and standardization, I think are very important. And I feel as a system, we have not paid as much importance to it. Now, we are not paying importance to it because we want to. I think now we are paying importance to it because we are under pressure. Under pressure from the world to follow things. With WTO, TRIPS and all the whole thing, we are under pressure to abide, to fall in line. And that's my perception.
Absolutely. The third point was that we've been lacking in systems. The Americans have been able to effectively sort out this problem with systems, create uniformities, homogeneity, and it has enabled them to move forward and create large-scale operations. Yes, this is absolutely true. In India, we are being frog march. You know what a frog march is? You see police wala jo haath peeche mod ke aap chala rahe hote bande ko, that is frog march. We are being frog marched into that kind of modernity. We would be talking about, ma'am, next time that we meet, we would be talking about small scale systems and large scale systems. India was characterized by small scale systems.
Yes.
India developed small scale systems and was great in working with small scale systems. Our problem started with the East India Company hit us and said, no, small scale systems won't work anymore. Large scale systems is what we need, and we didn't know what to do. And yet we did not have any resistance to large scale systems. Unlike in America where there is a resistance to large scale systems and homogeneity, in India we were completely comfortable. Jab hame kisi bhi kaam is tarah se kaam karo, hum karne lage. So wahan pe, next time that we meet, we will be talking about this at greater length.
Thank you very much.
How long have you been a content society, like in the past? You said that we were content with whatever we had. So
yes,
we did not expand
our...
Yes, see, two or three things about being contented. One is, I mean, the when we were talking about the textile industry, I had said that the textile industry, as it came up in the 1850s, 1860s and 1870s, it involved families. The father, children and the wife will come to Bombay or to Kanpur or to Nagpur and then work in the industry. Now this obviously from the European point of view makes sense if the capitalist is exploiting everyone. In the Indian context we don't see anyone rebelling. So bachche bhi khushi se kaam kar rahe hai, biwi bhi khushi se kaam kar rahi hai, aadmi bhi khushi se kaam kar raha hai. Strikes hona shuru hote 1870s mein, jab external pressures aate hain. So I don't know whether I should use the word contented, to be contented ke liye jab tak positive evidence nahi milega, hum strongly use to nahi bol sakte. But I'm really accepting that discontent is not being expressed in negative ways anywhere. We don't see complaints being made. So if we don't see complaints being made, then at some point we will have to say people were more contented. Because when we compare this with Europe and America of these times, we discover that those guys are complaining like mad. And that kind of complaint system we still don't have in India. In India, there was a brief patch in which people would complain too much about anything and everything. But by and large, they don't. I don't know what kind of colleges you guys are going to. I go to a college, my university, students don't complain about anything other than ki roti theek se nahi bani thi, daal mein tadka mein mirchi zyada thi. In contrast, JNU mein, Hyderabad mein aur Jadavpur mein, wo complain kar rahe ki duniya badal do, duniya kharab hai, sare systems kharab hai, rebellion le aao. So that is what discontent is. What my students show me in Punjab University, that is great contentment. My small suspicion is that wherever you guys are located in your respective colleges, all of you are very contented also. Yeah, anyone else?
So,
yeah.
So, that's organizing and having a system to work under. Working under fixed templates doesn't somehow inhibit
creativity. Absolutely. This is a dilemma between being creative, being part of the system, being a homogenized person. Does it inhibit creativity? Does it inhibit individualism? Does it inhibit the individual being expressive? This is a dilemma to which till now neither the philosophers nor the scientists have been able to find a decent answer. What I can assure you is this, that there are plus points to being obedient and there are plus points to being disobedient. And there was an engineer, a fellow called Pareto, and one day Pareto decided that he had enough of engineering and now he was working as a sociologist. He was trying to understand society. So he came up with this theory about the lions and the foxes. Machiavelli had said that society is run by foxes. Pareto said that no, it's not like this. Sometimes you have to behave like a fox, sometimes you have to behave like a lion, sometimes you have to behave like a tiger. You keep on switching, and occasionally when it's not possible for you to switch, you simply are sidelined, and those people who are capable of behaving like this, they come into place. Think about the Communist Party. Rahul Gandhi is a great boy, great fellow. But 40 साल का आदमी उसको अभी भी लोग boy बोलते हैं। 40 साल की उम्र में तो फौज में होता तो ब्रिगेडियर बन रहा होता, नेवी में होता तो कैप्टन हो रहा होता, यूनिवर्सिटी में होता तो सीनियर प्रोफेसर बन चुका होता, बिजनेस में होता तो he would have been owning one of the biggest businesses of his time, and yet he doesn't know what to do with himself. Look at Sukhbir Badal and Gautam. Sukhbir Badal is approximately the same age group, and he kicked out all his enemies, he controlled the state of Punjab, he is the sole wholesale ruler of Punjab. Look at Akhilesh Yadav. Different strategies of work. The same strategy does not work in every situation. You need to adjust yourself to new kind of ways of working. This is something which required an engineer, Pareto, to tell us. And in case you ever get an opportunity, please do read Pareto's books. They are all available on the internet now. And he would give you marvelous insights on how society functions and where obstructions can come before you. Thank you so much. Namaskar.